For those who don't know Farhana, Ibrahim is Associate Professor of Sociology and Social Anthropology at the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences at IIT Delhi. She received a PhD in Sociocultural Anthropology from Cornell, and before that her MPhil from the University of Delhi in Sociology. Farhana works on the study of borders, migration, and ethnographic perspectives of the state. Her book, Settlers, Saints, and Sovereigns, an Ethnography of State Formation in Western India, is based on ethnographic research among pastoralists in the Western, in Gujarat, along the Kutch-Sindh border. She's written widely on borders and communities in journals such as EPW and contributions to Indian sociology. And she's currently working on a book that looks at cross-border marriage migration in Kutch from the 19th century to the present. Her talk today is titled Wedding Videos and the City, Neighborhood Kinship and Community in the Aftermath of the Gujarat Earthquakes. Farhana.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Raka. And thanks for being here. I'm going to read my paper and show you some still photographs, not videos, I'm very sorry. Okay. So I'm in the large living room of a newly built house in the suburbs of Bhuj, the administrative center of Gujarat's Kutch district, on a bitterly cold winter evening in January 2013. This is Mohammad Hussain and his wife Sherbano's new home, the fourth since an earthquake displaced them from the heart of the old walled city 12 years previously. Mohammad Hussain has been my research assistant since I began work in the area in 2001, also the year of the earthquake. And in this paper, I use his and his wife's real name. That's what they would like. Other names I have changed. This evening, we are all engrossed in watching family wedding videos. Somebody has borrowed a video cassette player from a friend. Old VHS cassettes that had meticulously recorded family weddings until the advent of the CD are pulled out and played one after another in a room filled with relatives, three generations of family. Watching with the family, I note that the viewing produced various affects. Some of their reactions are along expected lines, others less so. Thus, while some dwell in the emotionally charged moment of a daughter's separation from her natal home, others are amused at what appear to be old-fashioned haircuts and styles of clothing on much younger selves. Others are viscerally reminded of kin who had died in the disaster. The videos also evoke a startling surge of excitement during scenes that display the old neighborhood, captured now on camera after the earthquake destroyed large sections of the city in January 2001. The loss and reconstitution of home as physical structure and affective space, consequent to political violence, militarization, religious conflict, or climate-related disaster, appears to be a mark of our times. Scholarship on displacement in South Asia has focused on movement across political borders in the wake of the various partitions of the subcontinent, on the reconstitution of the social fabric of the city and the neighborhood in the aftermath of violent events like riots and pogroms, and also on urban demolitions. This paper attempts to understand the process of reconstituting community and neighborhood in the aftermath of the Gujarat earthquake of 2001. Broadly, the paper seeks to make two related arguments. First, it proposes that climate-related displacement might be analytically different from that of people seeking refuge after episodes of war and conflict, where the destruction of neighborliness rather than the neighborhood itself might become the source of displacement. The possibility of return is performed differently in either case. Thus, I ask, what kind of return, physical, social, emotional, binds the new community of resettlement to the old? How does the past, as bittersweet memories of childhood homes and shared celebrations such as marriages and birthdays, but also of loved ones buried under earthquake rubble, creep into the present, projected in the discourse of urban planning as a fresh, new, and often upwardly mobile start? Second, it seeks to engage with literature on Muslims in South Asian cities that is increasingly grappling with the notion of the Muslim ghetto as analytical tool rather than a folk concept. This is what Lauren Geyer and Christoph Jaffrelot have said, for instance, in their work on Muslims in Indian cities. While post-earthquake urban settlement of Muslims in Kutch appears to have subsumed caste and occupational group under a more monolithic Muslim identity, including the spatialization of Muslims in a single geographical part of the city, I argue here that this does not necessarily generate social intimacy in the new neighborhood, nor is it key to the psychic rehabilitation of the post-disaster community. The new neighborhoods, constituted all at once through a violent and catastrophic event like the earthquake, present a clustering together of identities that are assumed to be homogeneous, but are nonetheless rife with difference and anxieties of various kinds that render impossible any attribution of seamlessness, coherence, or intimacy to them. Further, inhabitants of these so-called Muslim neighborhoods display neither a, I quote, subjective sense of closure nor a sense of estrangement from the rest of the city that are taken to be markers of the ghetto. Even as other inhabitants of the city perceive them as ghettoized and inward-looking, this ethnography reveals that reconstitution of community in the aftermath of displacement is premised on various forms of return to the old neighborhood that also situated them within various heterogeneous networks. The wedding video, I argue, constitutes one such mode of return to a past that is not nostalgia, but an active mode of producing community, a mechanics of neighboring, as Laura Ring puts it in her ethnography on urban neighborhoods in Karachi, and a mode of laying claim to the city as key players. To develop these arguments, I track the manner in which a single family, Muslim and middle class, has negotiated displacement, loss, and rehabilitation over a decade and a half since the earthquake. The wedding video, as I mentioned, is central to my argument, the viewing of which allows for the transcending of some of the dissipation, emotional and spatial, experienced in the aftermath of the earthquake, enabling the reconstitution of community and neighborhood. Wedding videos shot in the pre-digital, pre-earthquake period among Muslims who lived within the old walled city of Bhuj allow them to locate the pasts of a city in newly acknowledged archives that are constituted at the interstices of the so-called public and private. The viewing of these videos, chronicles of the quintessential family event, the wedding, may also be read as an ethnography of how the personal or the private speaks to a spectacular public event, such as a natural disaster. The ethnographic time of the paper moves between the viewing of wedding videos as well as reflections on the earthquake and its aftermath that took place in Bhuj between June 2001 and November 2015. The overall context of place and belonging is generated through the aftermaths of the earthquake. Yael Navarro Yashin recommends what she calls an ethnography of melancholia to understand what it means for people to be living among the ruins and debris of war, with affect produced at the intersection of the human and the non-human. Ruined spaces, debris, and appropriated houses generated melancholic affects in the post-war society she studied. Here, affect is produced in Kutch, that is, affect is produced not just in the literal habitation of the ruin or debris, of which there is plenty, but I argue in the space that is generated through the viewing of the wedding video, a space that enables a dwelling in, but also a possibility for transcending ruin. The paper concludes that moving on from the loss of home is a social process rather than a state-directed enterprise, and that social intimacy is not inherently given in ethnically or religiously segregated housing. The process of neighboring is one of constant striving. Intimacy is produced sporadically in ways in which the possibility of return to the old neighborhood and networks produces a new community of settlement. So physical relocation alone does not complete this process of rehabilitation until these other aspects of loss, mourning, and displacement are attended to. So I'm suggesting that the wedding video becomes one way in which to begin to address the affective response to resettlement by those uprooted by the earthquake. Briefly on the wedding video, the Indian wedding video does not supersede the photo album as a visual and material object pertaining to the wedding. In addition to documentation of the wedding as event, the video adds elements of entertainment such as film songs, creating a text that can be viewed repeatedly. I apologize for not having stills from this. This is still work in progress and I haven't gotten around to this, but it, so you'll have to just description. Anthropological literature on wedding photography and videography is drawn mostly from Asia and focuses on the indexing of fashion, status and modernity through wedding photography and videography. In India, more specifically, Janaki Abraham suggests that wedding videos are a distinct genre on the cusp of entertainment and the social. They detail the ritual core of marriage ceremonies as much as they are embellished by visual and musical special effects. In the wedding videos I watched in Bhuj, the focus was on the following themes: collective feasting, the public display of gifts sent with the bride to her in-laws' home, the wedding procession or the marat, and the bride's final leave-taking or the vidai. And in this paper, I'm particularly interested in the wedding procession. Wedding processions move from the groom's house to the location of the ritual proceedings, usually the Jamaat Khana or community hall, distinct structures owned and managed for most of the larger occupational subcastes in Bhuj, Hindus, Muslims alike. For Hindus, it's called the Samajwadi. Neighborhood space, as it is produced on the video, thus reflects the physical negotiation of space by the camera person, always a cameraman actually, and his crew as they move through narrow streets with the bulky camera equipment of the time. The shots in these videos thus favor public spaces of the street and overviews of the neighborhood rather than smaller, more private by lanes and streets that would have been trickier to negotiate with the camera. This is pre-digital technology, so the camera equipment is rather bulky. The city thus enters the videotape through the physical intervention of the camera-bearing person, and here I follow Elizabeth Edwards' work on photography, sharing a very particular experience of the landscape with the audience of the wedding video. So returning to the chilly evening, we were all viewing the wedding videos. Mohammed Hussein, who had joined the viewing party late, animatedly pointed out familiar streets and by-lanes of his old neighborhood within the walled city. Pulling a chair up close to the television screen, his back to other viewers, he focused intently on the unfolding cityscape. As the camera followed a marriage procession winding down the streets he had known since he was a child, he marveled at a shot of the Jamaat Khana, pristine and unmarked by the deep cracks that the earthquake was to bequeath it subsequently. The video rendition of the marriage procession became visual evidence of what he immediately recognized as having already become the past of his neighborhood, both in terms of the landscape and human relationships viewed on screen. Just briefly, sorry I went on, but just to tell you about the earthquake, which occurred on the 26th of January, is estimated to have killed a very large number of people, and Kutch had, had a and sort of a significantly larger share of the people who were reported injured and died. As of January 2004, there were well over 200,000 fully collapsed and over 900,000 damaged houses in the district. So almost every family actually had some way in which they had encountered the catastrophe fairly directly, if not actually through the loss of home and the loss of a member of family, etc. And I'll return to some of these. These are just some stills taken a couple of years after the earthquake. These are from 2003, where the rubble had already been cleared away, but you get the sense of of these vast sort of tracts of empty land in neighborhoods. So I'll return to some of this. The stack of wedding videos that started off as some family entertainment one particularly chilly winter evening soon had a growing audience. In subsequent viewings, new neighbors and relatives, who now live scattered across the city, dropped by to watch. While some of these were chance gatherings, others were planned, as when Mohammed Hussein invited his older brother, who had moved back into the old city some years after the earthquake, having built himself a new house to replace the old one. His exhortations to his brother on the phone, and I'm translating, the entire old city is visible as it was before the earthquake. It looks absolutely the best. End quote. These viewings created a space that provides a window into the manner in which the aftermaths of the earthquake were experienced, and also signal the complex relationships of what I term an accidental archive, what an accidental archive bears with the event it purportedly enables us to discuss. During these aftermaths, negotiation with kin, self, and neighborhood was an emotional and a continuous process as people settled and resettled in the aftermath of the disaster. Following Edward Simpson's writing on this earthquake, I underscore the importance of the aftermath to highlight that the disaster was more than an event if by the latter we invoke the spectacular singularity of an occurrence. Veena Das's work on the aftermaths of violence in North India suggests that the time of trauma does not freeze. People generate an eventual everyday from the ruins of the actual everyday, learning to live in that very space of devastation yet once again, end quote. From this perspective, the time of catastrophe is not set apart from the everyday, it is woven into it. We might say that the everyday is constituted through the very working out of cataclysmic events that people experience. While the earthquake provides an overall framework of loss and displacement that necessitated the reconstitution of home for those described here, by going back to the viewing of wedding videos, I seek to unravel the microprocesses of coming to terms with the loss of a home through a more everyday register, to reflect on what it might mean to pick up the pieces of a life shattered by disastrous happenings. The everyday is then not mundane ordinariness, but the knotty processes inherent in the living of a life, the ceaseless work that it demands. Das's concept of the descent into the everyday indicates this textured sense, not a space of banality after all, but a site of effort that produces life from the debris of calamity or disruption. The videos are thus not mere representations of a nostalgic past, but through their viewing, they become affective and material modes of producing a relationship to the neighborhood and a somewhat settled sense of the present in the face of a post-disaster reconstruction of the city that has relegated Muslims to its peripheries. Post-disaster reorganization of city space in Kutch cannot be isolated from other aftershocks that also left their marks on the fabric of life for Muslims in Gujarat, as we are all aware. A year after the earthquake, a pogrom against Gujarat's minority Muslim populations led to widespread murder, loot, and mayhem, irrevocably altering the social constitution of living spaces in many cities across Gujarat. Muslims appeared to cluster together in search of safe living environments across the state, across Gujarat, even as the state retreated from these spaces, providing little or no social or civic support. Meanwhile, in post-earthquake Bhuj, town planning schemes were implemented and broad roads were built, considerably extending the boundaries of the city, changing the manner in which its residents experienced urban space. I'll come back to this, but these were the new regulations. So all roads had to be wider and no structure could exceed 1 story in height. So this facilitated a lateral expansion of the city. So these new regulations changed the way in which its residents experienced urban space. Soon big cars entered the interiors of a city where once only two-wheel transport could navigate the narrow streets. Shopping malls, multiplex cinemas, hotels and restaurants proliferated along these arterial roads. Those who had lost their homes and families amidst the rubble of collapsed building in the inner city moved, often with compensatory payments in hand, to a newly emergent suburbia where over time large housing societies flourished. New elites emerged. As early as 2004, the chief minister of the state of Gujarat, of which Kutch is a district, who's now the prime minister, declared that the people of Kutch should, and I quote, put the earthquake behind them because the rest of Gujarat had already forgotten about it, end quote. So post-earthquake discourses of urban redevelopment sought to convert Bhuj into a zoned and a modern city after the earthquake. The walled city center was the focus of many of these interventions, for an earlier wave of expansion had already led to the development of residential colonies immediately outside the walled city. The redevelopment of Bhuj was planned as a collaborative venture between the government of Gujarat and a private planning agency, enabled by funding from a USAID project. Town planning, shortened to TP in local usage, was effectively outsourced by the state to a private agency, which worked on a model that was presented to residents in a series of public consultations before being finally adopted by the government. So this is, you can see how the roads are being widened. So once you've cleared the dense living areas, sort of new roads were sort of coming up. By the time of our collective viewing session in 2013, most of the streetscapes of the old town of Bhuj had altered substantially. Suburban housing colonies were ready, some built by the authorities for people in exchange for their former land within the precincts of the old city and elsewhere. Others were privately built by a burgeoning class of realtors. Not unlike former neighborhoods in the old city, suburban colonies seem to be organized according to a social, if not always entirely secular, logic. The old city had been much more strictly planned by royal decree, according to subcaste or occupational group, after which each little neighborhood was named, Hindu, Muslim, Jain. So thus we had Khatri or Nagar Chakla, Chakla meaning square, Vora Falia, which is a name, Sumra Delhi, which is a gateway, and so on and so forth, named after the caste of the community that inhabited it. New suburbs, on the other hand, clustered into a more broadly homogeneous upper caste Hindu demographic, giving a semblance of the dissolution of primordial caste-based social organization. So the town planners deemed this to be the new modernity of Bhuj, that you left behind caste-based social organization, and you're no longer organizing based on caste. What is more apparent, however, is that there is a much more clearly identified Muslim quarter in the redeveloped city. Given the small geographical scale of the old city, the distance between streets and neighborhoods was small. People walked from one area to another to access markets and temples or mosques, making it easy to meet across caste or religion, despite technically segregated living. So I don't want to talk of a kind of nostalgic past where everyone lived together and was happy, because there was a very sort of strict residential segregation, but the scale was very small, and so people did meet each other. And I'll give you a small example of this. In 2001, when I rented an apartment for my year-long stay in Bhuj, when I was doing my dissertation research, in a residential area that had been developed as an early pre-earthquake suburb, settled by middle-class and upper-caste Hindus, Mohammed Hussain discovered that he knew my landlord, a Rajgaur Brahmin. Rajgaur Falia was adjacent to Khatri Chakla in the old city, and Mohammed Hussain knew the entire clan, having literally grown up alongside them. My landlord himself, on the other hand, was a relatively recent returnee to Bhuj, having lived in Zanzibar all his life. So he had no familiarity with his ancestral neighborhood. So these kinds of, the mosaic of inner city life, segregated by religion and subcaste, yet constantly engaged with one another in the production of self in everyday life, despite political and social cleavages, soon gave way after the earthquake to more distant colonies, which were further away from old markets and social networks. It costs much more now to have to drive into town to patronize old shops, many of which change their locations after town planning anyway, seeking more lucrative positions on the edge of wide roads. Spatially, Muslims now tend to occupy the northwestern suburbs, while the southern extensions of Bhuj tend to be predominantly upper caste Hindu, and you have a sense of the ring road which has been planned around the city. The lake right in the center, Hamirsar Lake, is on the edges of the old walled city. So you really get a visual sense of how much the city has expanded. The earlier the entire extent of the city would have literally just been around the lake. So spatially, Muslims now tend to occupy the northern and northwestern suburbs, while the southern extensions of Bhuj tend to be predominantly upper caste Hindu. The southern suburbs shade into the broad highways leading out of Bhuj to destinations in southern Kutch such as Mandri and Mundra, and are lined with upscale car dealers and supermarkets. On the other hand, many of the northern and western suburbs have poor municipal services such as access to piped water or regular garbage collection. As I will argue below, moving out from the heart of the old city to a geographically distinct Muslim suburb serves to identify it as desirable and safe as a living place for its inhabitants. Yet the shrinking space of interactions with non-Muslims is perceived by them as a loss of community, which I'm arguing is also a comment on their perceptions of their changed relationship to the city more generally. And I'll explain this a little bit with a brief biography of relocation. Khatri Chakla, or Square, was an exclusively Khatri neighborhood in the old walled city, and Mohammed Hussain's old house was a version of the undivided ancestral home. In the traditional manner, it had a courtyard, a central courtyard, and a large terrace. On hot summer nights, string cots would be pulled out on the terrace, where the cool night air would lull the family to sleep. An avid bird watcher and nature enthusiast, deeply interested in learning about different cultures, Mohammed Hussain enjoyed pursuits that can only be described as eclectic within the context of the small provincial town he lived in. Over the years, he had developed a fairly extensive overseas network of friends due to tourism, because he acted as a tourist guide in his spare time. This overseas network of friends with whom he corresponded, collecting stamps from the many airmail letters he received. When he inherited his section of the family house, he named it Ashiana, that is nest or cocoon. Next to the front gate is a small marble nameplate with the name engraved in the Gujarati script. On the gate, however, is a metallic inscription in Japanese, now rusty and scratched. So this is the facade of the house. This is the Japanese inscription. Mohammad Hussain explains that he had once taken a short course in Japanese and, perhaps with the help of a visiting Japanese tourist, had commissioned the nameplate. He sees these seeming incongruities of inner city life in Bhuj by accounting for it as shock or interest. Mm. In the post-earthquake building boom, Mohammad Hussain acquired a plot of land in a new housing development that was to come up in one of the western suburbs of Bhuj, now the Muslim part of the expanding city. The new colony, called Tayyaba Township, was where middle-class Muslims bought land through a private realtor, also a Khatri. The realtor, who was also connected by marriage to one of Sharbanu's cousins, used the opening up of the real estate market in the post-earthquake period of Bhuj's development to relocate himself from another town further east, which had suffered greater earthquake damage than in Bhuj. In a scenario where life often had to be rebuilt from scratch, the post-earthquake building boom also allowed people to take risks that they perhaps would not have considered before. Thus, moving into Bhuj from the other relatively sleepy towns of Kutch became a way in which one could speculate on a different sort of future, especially in the context of the hype around its development and modernization, and a number of people that thus moved into Bhuj from surrounding towns. Many of them moved into newly burgeoning suburbs such as Tayyaba Township. Mohammad Hussain's house here is, and this is the house. So you can see visually it's very different from the old one. It's one of three Khatri homes in an all-Muslim housing society comprising about 25 houses of various sizes, a large arched gateway announcing the colony's name, an Arabic term meaning virtuous or pure. In Tayyaba Township, individual holdings are expansively laid out, a stark contrast with the narrow lanes and cluttered neighborhoods within the old city. Identically designed row houses exist opposite larger villas with gardens. All the occupants are middle-class Muslims. Poorer Muslims live in smaller tenements around the township, which is visually quite distinct from its surrounding areas. The emphasis here is on broad, clean streets, unbroken by grocery stores, vegetable vendors, or meat shops. While the poorer tenements on the outskirts of the township are cramped and crowded, live chickens are stuffed into wire baskets awaiting their buyers, but Sharbanu insists on taking a shared auto rickshaw into the old city every morning to buy the day's provisions that include meat, chicken and produce from the market in the old city, which he deems to be a more hygienic space. Reviewing the applicability of the ghetto as a sociological category, Lauren Gaye and Christoph Jaffrelot posit that as spaces of relegation, the ghetto is marked by the following characteristics, among them constraint in residential choice, class and caste diversity, neglect by the state, physical and infrastructural estrangement from the rest of the city, and a subjective sense of closure. The ghetto is analytically distinct from an enclave in their definition, as it precludes voluntary segregation. While Tayyaba Township displays some of the characteristics listed above, it does not partake of the politics of spatialization that tends to stereotype the Muslim neighborhood in a typical Indian city in terms of the visual and olfactory markers that pertain to non-vegetarianism, the slaughter of animals for meat, and so on. And people who have worked on this, particularly in the context of Bombay or Mumbai, have talked about how these markers are seen to be the typical markers of Muslimness in the cityscape. While the commercial area just north of Khatri Chakla in the walled city is called Mutton Market and is where raw meat and chicken vendors proliferate, known to all the residents of the old city as the place to go to for the purchase of these items, Tayyaba Township has none of these overt markers of Muslimness. It maintains a class exclusivity and is yet invisible to all but the Muslim residents of the city. When I visited Hindu friends on the other side of the city, they professed to have no idea at all about the whereabouts or even of the existence of these Muslim neighborhoods, even though they would always comment on the presumed alterity of their everyday practices. So for instance, I would hear, they don't eat rice like us, they eat biryani, they only watch Pakistani television dramas, and so on. Similarly, auto rickshaw drivers, while they did not necessarily mind driving me there, typically had or professed to have no idea of its location at all, unless they happened to be Muslim. So there's a way in which it's, despite this kind of the suburbanization and the expansion of this space, there's a way in which it becomes invisible to the others. Even as others have invisibilized the Muslim quarter, those who live there are engaged in the production of community by continually transcending its spatial incarceration, reaching out to older pre-earthquake neighborhoods and networks. The peripheralization of Muslims from city centers to distant suburbs is in keeping with what we know to be a progressive ghettoization of Muslims in post-colonial Indian cities, as their share of space, as their share of public space, has been declining from the early years of the partition onwards. Joya Chatterjee has shown this very well in the context of West Bengal, for instance. For the Muslims of Tayaba Township, however, the relationship between the new and the old neighborhood remained a generative source of belonging, or of longing almost. This belies one of the sociological attributes of the ghetto, that is, a subjective sense of closure and or alienation from the rest of the city. Despite the existence of at least two mosques within easy walking distance from the house, Muhammad Hussain prefers to ride into the old city on his scooter to offer prayers at one of his chosen mosques. Whenever possible, usually for the midday prayer, as he is now retired, he rides the additional distance to pray at the mosque facing the open square in Khatri Chakla, his earlier former neighborhood. While being in a Muslim neighborhood was deemed to be significant at some level because of safety in numbers and, you know, having a certain sense of security, the relationship between resettlement, neighborhood and home was a complicated one, making it difficult to assume intimacy based on a generic identity as Muslims in a ghetto-like situation. Patronage of mosques segregated followers on the basis of sect, to be sure. However, this was not the chief impediment to building a shared feeling of belonging to the neighborhood. The crucial distinction I found was between those who had relocated from the walled city in Bhuj and those who had had no prior ties to the city at all, having moved in from elsewhere after the earthquake. These neighborhoods, as I mentioned earlier, had a number of Muslim immigrants from other parts of Kutch and even Gujarat following the pogrom, seeking refuge in the aftermath of either disaster, earthquake or genocide. And the following section will reveal a couple of anecdotes. During the first week in January 2013 that I was privy to the collective viewing of these videos, various neighbors came to join in subsequent viewing sessions. Although they did not share a previous intimacy, and on some occasion were even meeting for the first time, the viewing of these videos generated an atmosphere of sociality and even kinship among those who did not necessarily share these attributes before. During one of these sessions, a woman, whom I call Salma, walked across to drop off the daily evening delivery of milk, as her delivery boy had not come to work. While Sherbano went into the kitchen to fetch a saucepan to receive the milk, Salma watched the images playing on the television screen. By the time Sherbano returned for the milk, Salma had recognized some people on the screen. She introduced herself to Sherbano as having lived in Bhuj for 40 years and her specialty as a practitioner of Desi Dawa, homemade medicinal remedies that could, in her terms, guarantee the birth of a child. Her family had supplied milk in the city and they relocated to Tayaba Township after the earthquake. On the screen, she identified some of her erstwhile clients. Sherbano, as fascinated as I by this exchange, insisted she stay and watch while a fresh round of tea was made with the just arrived milk. The sights of neighborhoods and people before the earthquake became a way in which shared bonds were forged between those who knew the city from its pre-earthquake times, regardless of whether they had been displaced into the suburbs or not. Muhammad Hussain's brother still lived in the old city, in a neighborhood that was not the same, either visually, socially or emotionally, but he came out to watch the videos with as much enthusiasm as his brother had invoked in summoning him there. Sherbano met a neighbor for the first time, their neighborliness aided by the wedding video and the shared memories they were able to summon up about the people on screen. Methodologically, the wedding video, in its dual address as chronicle of the personal event on the one hand, and a street theater, that is termed, Shuddha Vrata Sengupta talks of it as street theater, on the other, positions it on the cusp of the private and the public, allowing therefore a creative kind of blurring of the two domains in the context of memorialization of the earthquake. The earthquake was an event that was as spectacular in its public devastation as it continues to be intimately experienced at the level of the inner life. It is in this context that I suggest that what may be otherwise thought of as a private family album or a family collection may perhaps also be read as testimony to the pasts of a city and brought into debates on how one chooses to remember a past in the context of trauma. In a deeply moving ethnography about memory and place, Marianne Hirsch and Leo Spitzer discuss how walking and strolling through the city provided for a more immediate and personal form of remembrance, just as the genre of the street photo formed a bridge between urban and personal space. Patricia Hayes' work on photography in South Africa has drawn attention to some of the debates on the photographic archives of apartheid in contemporary South Africa, and she recommends a rethinking of what tends to be acknowledged as the public archive of history and the often less visible but nonetheless pivotal archive of that's private within family collections, or seen to be private. This is ultimately a methodological point that allows us to open up questions about the nature and form of address of the ethnographic archive. Photographs and other visual media have much to tell us, as we know, beyond their semiotic address. To this extent, much rich work on photography has attuned us to the context in which photographs evoke visual, haptic and tactile affects. They circulate in and out of archives, are used and exchanged within a visual economy. So I'm suggesting that perhaps some of this work on photography can maybe be drawn on to talk about the wedding video. I'm not sure, this is perhaps a suggestion or a thought. They allow us also to recalibrate notions of presence and absence in relation to the domestic or the familial. At the heart of the official post-disaster reorganization of the city, remember the comments that, you know, people have forgotten about the earthquake, so move on. So at the heart of this is also a question of reinstituting public memory through the built environment. The newly produced past may speak in various tongues to the pasts of a city or neighborhood as recalled by a passing generation of people or to their image collections at home. It may be a recasting of space and historical memory on the terms of those charged with its recreation, such as the town planning authorities. I have suggested here that the viewing of wedding videos filmed on the street becomes a way of performing and experiencing a different kind of urban affect than the one that is envisioned through post-disaster urban planning, which inculcates a certain kind of amnesia towards the past, even as it projects a future-oriented city. So it's constantly being compared to Singapore, that is going to be as modern as the new Asian hub, urban hubs. So I've argued today that older wedding videos constitute visual claims to the past of the city in the context of post-disaster reorganization of urban space that has concomitantly reordered the experience of space through residential practice. Despite the physical rearrangement of urban space that encodes a far more rigid spatialization of Muslims in certain geographical areas, paradoxically rendering them much more invisible to the rest of the city than they had ever been before, the residents of these new neighborhoods continuously strive to transcend their suburban lives, seeking instead connections that return to the old community and the old neighborhood. The wedding videos also evoke ties that are reminiscent of cosmopolitan connections that go beyond their identity as Muslims. So Muhammad Hussein's daughter's wedding party that I didn't actually talk about, but that was one of the videos that we watched, which catered to mixed wedding guests serving a vegetarian and a non-vegetarian meal on two separate days so as not to offend the sensibilities of his Hindu guests, and the Japanese nameplate on his door seek to establish urban connections that are far removed from the way in which he is spatialized or invisibilized in the expanding modern city. Finally, even as resettlement is presented as the end of a story of displacement, by states, urban planners, and others engaged in the rehabilitation of uprooted populations, in this case also NGOs, religious service organizations, this paper suggests that it is only the beginning. Based on long-term ethnographic engagement with a place, this paper is a fledgling attempt to understand how the practice of ethnography can address these non-narrative impulses. The collective viewing of the wedding video becomes, I argue, an important methodological archive to understand the community's attempts to resist marginalization in the city by casting itself neither as a homogeneous community of trauma nor through nostalgia for the past. These videos allowed us, both the anthropologist and her subjects, to locate archives of the city's past in new and unexpected places. Rather than seeking spectacular public memorials to the disaster and its aftermath, these so-called private collections may then have something important to tell us about how the various pasts of the city and of a community may be remembered. Thank you.
just do a few general questions.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Can I ask the first?
So, I sort of have two questions. The first is, it wasn't clear to me, sort of, maybe I missed at the beginning of the talk. Can you set up for me how the viewing took place? That is, how often did they watch? Whom did they invite to watch? I'm not clear about that.
Mm-hmm.
Would you just tell me that first, and then I'll ask my follow-up question.
Okay. So it started out just as a family viewing. People were bored one evening, and so it was just family, three generations of family sitting together at home watching wedding videos. I mean, yes, they were bored.
But this one wedding video.
It was a stack of them. So actually, I should clarify this. It was not just that they were bored. They were bored, but there had been some amount of preparation going into setting this up, because one of the sons had to borrow an old VHS player. No one had these anymore. So an old player had been borrowed, and a stack of these old cassettes that no one has been watching because they can't anymore. They don't have the technology to watch it anymore. So they were played one after another, literally just as family entertainment. It was in lieu of watching television. So that's how it started. But I'm arguing that there was this unexpected layer that was added onto it when people started noticing the city. So while some people were focusing very much on the people and the wedding, there were other people, particularly Mohammed Hussein, who was focusing on the city. And so what I'm arguing is, from this it worked outwards, is that then they actually had particular viewings where they called people. And they called people who they thought would enjoy looking at the city, because this was one place where you had now the city as it once was, because visually the city had just been completely undone. The old neighborhood was not the old neighborhood anymore. So this was one way in which you could access how it looked. So in subsequent viewings, they were setting it up not for the wedding at all. The wedding part was incidental, but it was just to look at the background, to look at these, to look at stills of the streets and the neighborhoods, and how that now we're going to come to so-and-so's house, and now on the left there will be so-and-so's house, because they don't exist anymore. Many of them are these just cleared up spaces. Now new roads have come. So the city is visually just very different. So that's how the viewing sort of happened. And people kind of came. So it started out, that's why I'm calling it a sort of accidental, because I don't think it was set up like that. It just happened. And I was present for that first viewing. And then for the 2-week period that I was there on that particular trip, there were these more planned viewings that were set up after that.
That's very interesting. It clarifies a lot, because I was going back to your term, sort of ethnography of melancholia, and I was thinking to myself, but in fact, what it is, a nostalgia. And mm-hmm. I wasn't quite convinced
mm-hmm.
that they were actively creating
mm-hmm.
a new community.
Mm-hmm.
But it seems to me that what you're showing is that they're actively doing both. They're both actively remembering what kept them together
mm-hmm.
as a community,
mm-hmm.
kept people together as a community, and by the act of inviting people in, trying to create new community.
Inviting people and people who happened to be there. Like, I think the anecdote about the woman who comes to deliver the milk, she actually had nothing to do with them, but she happened to be there, but got sucked into the viewing because of them sort of getting drawn into community by virtue of having a certain kind of recognition of the pre-earthquake past through particular people who she recognized on the screen, which was different. I mean, because I didn't have time, I didn't have the other narrative that went along with that, which is of some of their neighbors who they don't feel connected to because they've actually moved in from other parts of Gujarat after the earthquake. So they were not residents of Kutch at all, because of these new middle-class Muslim localities. Lots of people are relocating from other parts of the state as well, but then they don't have this connection to the place from before the earthquake.
So that's my last question. So I would imagine in the old chatla, in the old places they lived, people could walk into neighbors' houses, people were just, here and there. And in this space, there are no neighbors in that same way, it's broad. So can't it be thought of that they are actually, that woman who comes in to deliver milk is there by accident,
mm-hmm.
but it's the kind of thing that would happen in the old neighborhood, not in the new neighborhood
yes.
where,
Yes.
So is it also not nostalgia So now they're building not real community,
mm-hmm.
not real future community, but using the video to imagine a future community. Because mm-hmm. if the future community, if it looks like that, that's not going to be the same community mm-hmm. at mm-hmm. all.
Yes.
Right? So is it a real community they're building, or is it an imagined community through, like, the, you know, like the guy you're talking about?
Right. I think that's an interesting question. So I think, yes, it definitely is, there is a, you know, large part of imagination going on there. But I think it's also, so it's future and past. It becomes a way of sort of coming to terms with a certain kind of dislocation and loss, where you've lost your home, you've also lost some family members, and you've come out here. And on the one hand, there's a lot of prosperity, and you've moved away from the sort of the sort of congestion of the inner city, and you've come out and you've moved up in the world and all of that. But you're also sort of invisibilized, you're far away from everything. And so I think this new community is also a way of it's also a way of feeling connected. I mean, physically not, but
mm-hmm.
you know,
yeah.
but non-physically, you sort of hark back to things that actually connected you with the past, and all these other practices that relied on not just Muslims but other people who were very central to one's everyday, you know, in the old community, which seems to have gone away here.
I was interested in the mosques that are in that neighborhood
mm-hmm.
that Mohammed Hussein doesn't attend.
Mm-hmm.
And of course I can understand his reason for going back to the one that he was familiar with. But would it be the case that the ones in the neighborhood are only being attended by in-migrants from after the earthquake?
In migrants, but also, I mean, it's a neighborhood mosque, so it's for anyone who lives there. Actually, the plot that's right next to their house is earmarked for a mosque, which hasn't come up yet. He, of course, says that, yes, I think you're absolutely right, actually, because it's about the kind of people you meet in when you go, because it is about community, it is about your daily sort of, you know, meeting with people and chatting and talking and passing the time of day as well. And I think he does feel, but you know, what it's interesting is that when he goes back to the old mosque, he is not necessarily meeting people who he knows, because many of them have moved out as well. You know, the old neighborhood is not what it was either. In fact, a lot of it is now just sort of ghost town. You know, there are a lot of empty plots of land. People have the bulldozers came, they sort of erased the house, but many of them haven't built yet, they're living elsewhere. So the old community is not the old anymore either. It's interesting that, yeah.
I think in going to pray there might be some nostalgia too.
Yes.
Whereas community might be created in the neighborhood
mm-hmm.
by going to a new mosque.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah, no, absolutely. I think I agree with you. I think this is one part of it. I mean, he's often said to me when I've asked why he doesn't go, he, you know, attributes it to to various things, like the sound of the, you know, the person who gives the azan, you know, he's not very melodious, or, you know, other things like that. So there is, I think, a sort of a comfort factor with, you know, going back. But it is that extra distance that is, you know, one is sort of riding, which he can only do because he's not working anymore. But yeah, I think that's an interesting point. Okay, speak again.
So I thought it was interesting that you spoke about three generations of the family watching the video.
Mm-hmm.
But I think you concentrated a lot of your paper
yes.
on
yes.
the older generation and the nostalgia.
Yeah.
And you also made the point of the urban planning, the Gujarat DP department,
yes.
for
yeah.
example.
Yeah.
And I was wondering how the newer generation's aspirations for a more modern
mm-hmm.
way of life
yeah.
coincided with their father's, grandfather's view of the old city.
Mm-hmm.
And it occurred to me, so we saw something very similar in Bombay after the riots
mm-hmm.
Way back in 1993, where communities moved out of the center of the city, the Muhammad Ali area,
mm-hmm.
and we would have narratives. So I have lots of Muslim neighbors, and a lot of narratives of what it was like living in that area.
Mm-hmm.
And it notwithstanding the violence, of course, of what happened in Bhuj or any kind of displacement, it seems to me that the older generation wants to hold on to a memory and to instill the importance of that memory in the younger generation. This older and younger generation, if you could comment on their the bifurcation.
Right, and I also really only focused on Mahmud Hussain's narratives, and I should also mention here that it's not even a generational thing, it's also a gender thing. So his wife is actually not as nostalgic about the old. For her also, the because precisely what sort of what Raka was talking about, she feels liberated from the absence of people dropping by all the time, right? So it is also a gender thing, right? So for her it is the sort of the wide openness of it, the fact that, you know, she says that there is fresh air all the time, is very important. So the nostalgia is really sort of it's not really generational even. It breaks down. And certainly yes, for the younger generation, I think it's very interesting because again it's tied up with. So the move to the new colony also facilitated the breakup of the joint family, so the sons were able to get their own homes. And so while one son lives with them, the one who had brought the video, the player, the other one actually lives further away, and they share a car between them. They bought a car, but the car can only be parked here because, you know, this has the driveway and it has, you know, it has the vast space, etc. So yes, it's true that there is very much, and there's also, I mean, there's another section of the paper which I have talked about how the younger generation is really teaching their father about what it means to have moved. So, you know, what kind of an interior aesthetic one should aspire to. So, you know, they say that, for instance, you know, now that we've moved here, you shouldn't have sort of clothes lying strewn all over the place in bags. Like, we have like built-in wardrobes, so everything should be put away. So there is very much this kind of minimalist aesthetic in their house. Like, there's absolutely nothing on any surface, which is it's a very important inversion for them of their life in the old city, which was all about crowded spaces. The interior was very crowded. You know, now everything is, you know, everyone has their own bedroom, everyone has their attached bathroom. So there's a way in which this is very much something that the younger generation is kind of telling their parents that this is very important now that you've moved in. So they have the person who comes to clean the house comes twice a day to clean and mop the floors, you know, which is, I mean, I don't know really, I mean, maybe people do, but this was a little unusual for me to see because, you know, because the emphasis was on keeping the surfaces very clean. So I think that you're right, that for the younger generation, this really is very much about moving up, about upward mobility, about, so I think, yes, absolutely, you're right. This, little more to think through over there, but yes, so nostalgia, but is also only in sort of, I mean, I wouldn't want to say that it is nostalgia for everybody, even for a particular generation, but there are definitely these multiple narratives of what really home and belonging and displacement, what it means. Yes.
Just fascinating, very, very interesting. Especially, I lived in Anand from 2002 to 2006, you know, and I came from Kerala. Mm-hmm. So it was very distinct. You know, we have also 21% Muslim population in Kerala. Mm-hmm. But it was never ghettoized as in Gujarat. You know, when I go to buy meat, I go to Pakistan.
Right.
That was the word used. You know, we used to go to Pakistan. Even for fish, we had to go to Pakistan. Mm-hmm. And that's it. And so in Kerala, there was a class division. Otherwise, it was everybody used to kind of, it was continuous settlement. But you come to Gujarat, there is a caste and an ethnicity kind of a divide there, you know. So within this, there could be, in Anand, you know, there were two kinds of things. And only if you are a very, really upper class, you can actually kind of get out of that space. And so I think that was one observation that I had. Second interesting observation is, you know, what is your, or question is, what is, as a researcher, how did you feel? Because when Varghese Kurian went there, you know, he had to, you know, stay in the garage of this operative. Because he was a meat eater, He was a non-Hindu, so he took it. So I'm wondering, who was your landlord? And the third and last point, I'm now working in Bhuj, with Dairametra and the project. So this is the district which has gotten the highest growth rate. It's 16%, in the whole of South and Southeast Asia, because of Modi and the Adanis. All this, it's a huge kind of, inflow of investments and things coming in. So maybe it would be interesting to look at that angle also, what you see as this middle class right, also is coming from a lot of interest of capital and, the flow of capital. So I think in a future study, that would be a very interesting point to kind of make. Because Bhuj is now the kind of poster boy of Gujarat, Gujarat, the desert festival. All these things, Modi is actually kind of bringing in. So what is the kind of effect of that beyond these observations?
Right. Thank you. Those are very important and interesting comments. I'll start with the last. Yeah, I think this growth rate and the poster boy for Kutch is absolutely, Bhuj is the poster boy for Kutch, and it is such an island in some ways. And even within its, I think one of the points I'm trying to make here is that within this overall narrative of, because the narrative now is very much that we've moved on, everything has happened, and we're developed, and we've gotten where we want to go. There are these other aspects of, because a lot of this development is also premised in the post-earthquake phase on incredible amounts of loss of various kinds, human, physical, all kinds of things. And that is very interesting to see, because you see people who have seemingly sort of really moved up in the world, but there are these incredible kinds which you just can't sort of account for, right? What it means for people. So Mohammad Hussain's wife, for instance, which is again in the larger work I have, she doesn't have any natal family left, because 16 members of her natal family died in the earthquake, and all 16 of them, because the house collapsed. And so she has no sort of she doesn't have any natal family left. And that also comes out, it came out very poignantly during a wedding, actually, of her daughter, where she sort of collapsed and fainted because one of the ceremonies that has to be done where her brother's family is supposed to be there was nobody. Mm-hmm. So, so I feel that these are these moments where you see this coming out, which is why also the earthquake was never my research subject. I felt I couldn't talk about it. I couldn't ask people, what does it mean to have, suffered the earthquake? But part of returning there for 15 years regularly, I found that people started talking about it after a point. So it's only it's only about 10 or 12 years after the earthquake that I suddenly found that people began to talk about it. And the wedding videos became one moment where I found that suddenly people were talking about something that they hadn't talked about at all in my presence at all. So it became this moment which allowed for a certain kind of, so I think that's something which I'm interested in trying to explore, that how do you really talk about something like this, the kind of toll that it takes, even when publicly there is this narrative of, development and things. My own position as researchers is very, very interesting, because of course, I have a Muslim name, but for some reason I have never been taken. People have always said the most horrendous things about Muslims to me. That this is what they do, this is what they do. So I don't understand, I have not understood how I sort of, I really don't get this. So I think because in some ways I did not fit the stereotypical way in which a Muslim is supposed to look or something. So the Hindus in Bhuj have said some really truly awful things to me, but always sort of talking about them, making me an us. And for some of them who I have an interesting sort of biography, because my father's family is Muslim, my mother's family is Hindu, so those of them who knew that would use that to justify that, you think like us, and because, the mother has brought you up, etc. My Muslims was, they saw me as one of them, and so they felt very comfortable, and, so that was not a problem. I also live with them, after a point I stopped living in a hotel because they insisted I stay with them, so
That does mark me also as a researcher. But I mean, I have not attempted to. I mean, I feel like it's fine. This is the perspective that I have chosen to adopt. I don't think I can get this view of the in the Muslim sort of quarters, but that and the Hindu sort of in the Hindu parts of the neighborhoods. But that's fine. But so interestingly, yes, when I did live with a Muslim in the Muslim landlord's in the Hindu landlord's house. I'm so sorry when I was, but there was. You know, there was no question of any meat or even eggs. I mean, those were made very clear that you can't eat these things, which was, it was okay for me, I mean, at that point. Yeah, sorry.
So I have another kind of comment or question on how much we're talking about temporalities and past and futures and endings, because I'm also interested in the jizz tapes as an archive and as a form that's really, you know, you have to do the whole production to be playing your VHS tapes. Was there any sense of finality around just the technology by which these things are being memorialized, either for you or for the event?
So for me, yes, because I think I was immediately conscious of the fact that these are, well, they're not being produced like that anymore. The technology has changed, so you can't get those kinds of views of the street, but weddings have changed. So now you don't have street processions anymore because people are now choosing to get married in indoor, either tented spaces or indoor sort of marriage halls, hotels, etc. So the format of the wedding has changed too. People come in buses, etc. The barat comes. So it's both technology and the actual social process seems to have changed. So yes, there is something about these videos that is, I think, a very valuable kind of a resource or an archive that many families must have because they were, you know, sort of archiving. I mean, they were producing these videotapes throughout the 80s, 90s. That this period is covering.
So I was wondering if you could say a little bit more about your research of who has actually stayed in the old Chukla areas and how has the complete redevelopment there maybe created similar or parallel issues of community and grief and kinship.
Mm-hmm. In the old part of
the
town?
In the old part of the
right.
town, now has these broad streets. And
Well, the streets are widening, right. but there are fewer houses now because the streets have also eaten up into, you know, residential space. So I think that based on, I mean, I've tried and attempt an answer on this. My observations are that families have been completely split now. So earlier people lived, you know, so your neighbors were also your larger kinship universe because there were these very small, densely interconnected sort of caste and religious communities. And among the Muslims, they were also intermarrying communities. So you really had all your kinship universe were also your neighbors. But post-earthquake, because of different sort of, you know, what I've called sort of income and compensatory regimes meant that different people actually had different amounts of cash available that enabled them to decide how and where they would relocate. So if you were able to, exchange your plot of land or sell it to the government, that was what most people wanted. So if you got paid by the government for your land, then you could actually buy something in the suburbs. But if you couldn't, so if your house wasn't deemed to be so badly destroyed that you would get compensated, then you had to actually spend your own money to repair it. So it led to lots of different kinds of, schisms between families and communities. And a lot of this was really not about how much destruction they had suffered, but about how well they could bargain with the state to get the state to recognize a level of, you know, destruction. So people have stayed behind, people have left. This has often nothing to do with, you know, how much they lost. But typically for the people left behind, and this was your question, there's not much of a community because the neighborhood space has really fractured now. So there are lots of empty houses, empty plots of land. They comment on how in the evening it's, you know, everybody just retires home and shuts the door because most of the socializing happened outside post dinner, you know, men would hang out in these corner shops and women would be watching TV at home. So all that has actually ended. So one of the things that almost everybody says is that post dinner outside socializing is came to an end after the earthquake. Immediately after the earthquake, because you know people were there was too much trauma and too much destruction. But now, because you don't have the people to do it with, so you know people have kind of, even in the old neighborhood, people seem to have sort of come looking, be looking inwards rather than to the neighborhood.
Because in 2002 was the earthquake.
One.
And two was the riots.
Yeah.
So what is the kind? How do you kind of, you know, see that, you know, causality and, you know, how do you disaggregate this? You know, maybe due to 2002 that people are not getting out.
Yeah. I mean, I think I've always been arguing that the two have to be seen very closely interconnected. And I mean, what I talked about, the sort of the spatialization and the movement of Muslims into these, is also linked to 2002. Certainly the influx of other Muslims who were not in Bhuj at all, who have come here to live here, a lot of that is driven by fear from being in other parts of Gujarat. Within Bhuj itself, of course, there was no direct sort of incident of violence against Muslims, but certainly the overall, you know, the rhetoric of anti-Muslim violence. So I think yes, the two have to be seen. I think the larger sort of post 2001/2 sort of reorganization of urban space has to take into account both. In many cases, actually, I think in rural areas, for instance, there was a much clearer inscription of, you know, of a certain kind of Hindutva spatial organization in villages. That was much more sort of stark in some ways than in the... I'm also talking not about Muslims who were rehabilitated by, you know, relief agencies and organizations. I'm talking here about sort of voluntary relocation, people who bought their own plots of land. Again, it's a different story where if you talk about like Islamic Relief Committee, for example, right, you know, where you have a certain notion of different kind of sect affiliations and how people change, or, you know, their religious practice sort of gets different in order to qualify for aid from a particular kind of committee. Here I'm talking really about better off Muslims who are moving into these more middle class localities, sort of self, you know, driven. Sorry.
So yeah, I was just tying all these comments together. I'm really thinking about class and community together. So there's a American sociologist who writes about actually the black experience in the cities called William Julius Wilson. And one of the things he said is that earlier in the ghettos, is basically of the cities, Chicago or whatever, because of segregation, middle class blacks and poor blacks lived together.
Mm-hmm.
Because they couldn't go anywhere else, they were all in the same place. So there was a certain kind of community and interaction between working class and middle class. You know, the policeman knew the child, you know, okay. But after the civil rights movement, when the middle class blacks could take and segregation was lifted, residential segregation, then the only people who could actually take advantage of it was the middle class blacks. So they move out, leaving behind sort of these places where only the poor lived, right? So what happens long term is that a community that was, yes, ghettoized, but united by across class,
mm-hmm.
by the community, that fractured. And it seemed to me that's what may have happened here as well.
Yes.
It's just those who could, that house is not a middle class house, it looks like an affluent house,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
So has the community in some sense fractured by class?
Yes, absolutely. Because as I said, that they moved out, but where they moved to was dictated by their class or their emergent class position.
Yeah.
A lot of, there's also been a very interesting sort of, there's been a lot of speculation in land post-earthquake. So families who were really not that well off seem to have moved up. They seem to have, I don't know how sort of, you know, durable this new class position is, but they seem to have suddenly moved into a different kind of class. And then that's matched by certain kinds of consumption patterns,
mm-hmm.
that make this even more visually, you know, sort of apparent.
So certainly in this Tayaba township, they are surrounded by these sort of much poorer Muslims who are very close. They're right there. But here there is this, the Tayaba township is not a gated community, but it has all the trappings of a gated community should they want to do so in the future. So even the gateway that you saw, it's not functioning like a, but it can be closed, you know. So there is very much a certain kind of, as I said, it has all the trappings of a gated community, which is not, it's open right now. But there are these other markers of class, etc., that separate it from these other sort of colonies around it, which are also entirely Muslim. But this is where you have the people in the shanties. They're not, they don't have access to water and etc. But that's also where you have, as I said, all these, you know, all the so-called Muslim markers of urban life in India are there. You know, you can the meat shops and the chickens, and they're there. But
now they're separate.
They are separate, and they choose to not, the people of this colony chooses to go into the further away.
Yeah.
So it's about also maintaining class.
This makes them more vulnerable. Right?
Yes.
Or already the rest they're vulnerable.
Yes.
If they're together, I think there is some possibility that some police help or some people come.
Yeah.
This will really segregate.
And I think this may go back to Alice's point about the mosques also. I don't think I have material about this entirely, but it would be interesting to see if some of these people also came to these mosques in the area, and that so to not go to this mosque may also then become a marker of class separation.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. It could be. I'm just speculating. I'm not sure about that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I'm just curious about the vilification of the Muslims and the Muslim identity that was revealed to you. And I wonder how much of it was already existed prior to 2002, and how much of it was a narrative of the 2002 violence. If you can comment on it, having lived there for such a long time.
Yeah, my research really though began around sort of 2000, 2001. So it's hard to say. I don't have enough of a my research really sort of has been in the shadow of these two very large sort of events in Gujarat, both earthquake and the right.
I was wondering, said that the new township, the Nayaba township, is almost invisible to the Hindus that you spoke to.
Right. Invisible in the sense that they seem to have no clue. They would always say, where do you stay? And I would say that I live with this family that lives in Tayaba township, and they would say, but where is that? You know, so... even though they are not, they are perfectly well aware of the newer Hindu townships that are, you know, as further away, but in a different geographical direction. But that's also because of, part of, you know, like I said, that there are no grocery stores, nothing. Part of it also is because nobody is setting it up here. You know, these are, the Muslims who live here are not, they're not, you know, grocers, and this is not their job. So none of them have set up stalls or shops in this area. So then they would be dependent on someone else setting up a shop. Then it's, you know, not... So these are, as I said, they're well-to-do. They have the money to spend. But people have not... Hindus or the trading communities who actually run the Kirana stores, etc., in the other parts of town have not, you know, set it up here. So because of that, there is a sense in which it's, you know, it's very well laid out, and it's, you know... There's all this affluence, but then there's none of the other infrastructural support that makes a well-off community, you know, so in terms of shopping, or I mean, that just doesn't exist. So I think it could be because also of, you know, people not coming. So it is quite invisibilized.
I have a question about the access to municipal services you're talking about before. So in the Tayaba township, like, because it looks much more affluent, you said the northwest area generally doesn't have as much access. So Tayaba township does have access services, but the surrounding tenements don't have access.
So Tayaba township will have running water, etc. Okay. But generally in that area, you will find that there's not as much attention to, so, you know, they talk about how their, you know, trash isn't collected as regularly, and etc. But they go to great lengths to, that's the other thing I'm arguing. I think there is a production of... There's a lot of work that goes into sort of maintaining this area visually very distinct from the old area, at least where some Bhuj people came from. You know, so there is a lot of focus on, you know, having a yard, having a driveway, having, you know, being making sure that
you know, this stuff doesn't spill out onto the public common areas in a way that it does in the poorer part of the neighborhood, which of course doesn't have access to piped water or anything at all.
Thank you so much for a really fascinating talk and conversation.
Thank you.
Thank you.